right? And also make it much more interesting for everybody. Now, my lecture, the first lecture today, is about large quantities of cheap nanocrystallized matter. When I talk about large quantities, I mean millions of tons. There's not a very small amount of carbon nanotube or a tiny amount of amorphous metal and so forth, but very large quantities. And by cheap, I mean approximately 10,000 times cheaper weight by weight than potato crisps. Okay, so it has to be material which you can use in engineering applications, structural applications. And I'll explain to you why you want to go to very, very fine scales in the microstructure. So I'll start by saying why we need these materials, how we could produce them, talk a little bit about the theory, the role of interfaces, because as you make the material finer and finer, you're putting more and more surface per unit volume inside your material. And eventually the cost of creating those surfaces can become very large. Okay, because after all, a surface is a defect. And from that consideration, you'll come out with some theory which says, look, this is the finest size that we can achieve for this given set of conditions. If you want to predict what is the finest size we can achieve by processing in a particular way. There are many reasons why we want to go to a smaller and smaller crystal size. And one of the most important reasons is that we want to make the material stronger. This is the classic plot of strength versus the size of crystal in your polycrystalline material. And it's of course known as the hole patch relationship, where the yield strength increases with 1 over the square root of the size of the crystal. So this is 1 over the square root of the size of the crystal. So as the crystals become finer and finer, so you can see over here, we are talking about 20 nanometer size crystals. Here we are talking about 1 micrometer size crystal. As the crystals become finer, the strength increases. Here we are talking about something like 1500 megapascals measured using a normal tensile test. In a tensile test, you simply pull the sample and you measure the point where the strain starts to become classic strain. So this is one reason why we want finer. But as you know, in engineering, just one property is not important. You have to think also about the ability of the material to absorb energy when it fractures. Okay? And that is what we call toughness. And there might be many other properties that you need to consider. But let's assume that for the moment we concentrate on strength. Strong materials, making very strong materials by reducing the scale of the microstructure. Now, it becomes very difficult to think about what a strength of 2 gigapascals means. Yeah? It's just like when your government announces a budget that there's so many trillion dollars. Yeah? It doesn't mean very much to the ordinary person who earns $1,000 maybe. Yeah? So I want to explain to you the meaning of very, very high strength. And I'll explain this in terms of an analogy. This is an apple, as you know. And you remember the famous story about how gravity was discovered, if you like, when an apple fell on top of Newton. Yeah? Now, the weight of a typical apple in scientific units is actually 1 newton, because a newton is a force, and weight is a force. So one apple weighs approximately 1 newton. If I put that on 1 square meter, then that is 1 pascal of stress. So when I talk about 1,000 megapascals, I mean I'm putting 1 billion apples on 1 square meter. So the material can support the weight of 1 billion apples on 1 square meter. And I'm going to talk about even higher strength than 1 gigapascal. I'll talk about strength of 5 gigapascals, which means you can put 5 billion apples on 1 square meter. So we are talking about incredibly high values of strength. It's very easy to talk about large numbers, but we appreciate the meaning. These are very strong materials that can support enormous loads without plastic transformation. So stop me if you have any questions at any time. Now here is commercially available steel. It's produced by Kobe Steel in Japan. And it consists of a steel wire called Cypher. Cypher stands for scientific iron. Okay, it's a short form of scientific iron. It has a strength of 5.5 gigapascals. That means that it can support the weight of 5.5 billion apples on 1 square meter. And it is still very ductile. Look, you can tie a knot in this wire. Now, if you take carbon fiber, it has a strength of about 3 gigapascals and zero ductility. So this is a remarkable material. And the way it is produced is by taking a mixture of ferrite and martensite and severely deforming it. If I take about 50 grams of material and I stretch it out into 2 kilometers, then that's a strain of about 9. It's very severe deformation to produce a wire which is as strong as this and still extremely ductile. So this is a case where we produce strength by introducing defect inside material, because deformation introduces lots and lots of dislocation. Everyone knows what dislocations are? They're basically defects which in fact reduce the strength of the material when you start with a perfect crystal. A perfect crystal has very high strength, but as soon as you put dislocations, the strength collapses. But then when you put many dislocations, the strength increases again because they start to interfere with each other. So this material is produced by first of all taking steel and heating it into the austenite phase field, quenching it so that you get a fully martensitic structure. And this is strong but not particularly strong. This is only a 0.2 weight percent carbon steel. So the strength here is of the order of 1,000 megawatts. You then heat it up into the two-phase field, austenite plus ferrite mixture, and quench it again so you get a mixture of ferrite and martensite. You then take this microstructure and you severely deform it by drawing it out into a very fine wire. Now remember, the deformation involved is very, very large. And although we have two phases here, martensite and ferrite, the deformation will actually mix them up. They will become a single phase. The martensite and ferrite will combine together because we are putting so much deformation into the material. Now, we can study what happens to the structure on an atomic scale using an instrument known as a field ion microscope. Now, a field ion microscope, you basically make a needle out of your material, a very sharp needle. Then you put a very large electrical field around that needle, and the electrical field will have lines going this way, and when you pull atoms out of the surface, they will follow the lines of force, and that will lead to a magnification of about 10 million times. So you're able to see individual atoms, and in this image, each dot is a single atom. What I'd like you to focus on is these dark regions here. These are crystallographic planes, basically. You know, if you take a sphere and you section it, then you see planes of atoms. You can see these rings. But these are regions which are defects. They are drain boundaries. What we've done by deforming this material so severely is introduce grains which are of the order of 5 nanometers in size. Very, very fine grain structure. And that is what is giving most of the strength to this cipher. Most of the strength comes from the very fine grain structure. Now, in this instrument, we can also pull out individual atoms by applying an electrical pulse and identify them chemically by measuring the time it takes for the ions to fly between two points. In other words, time of flight mass spectroscopy. So we have atomic resolution both spatially and chemically. We know exactly what the atoms are and where they are located. And what happens when you do that chemical analysis on an atomic scale is that this was my ferrite and this was my martensite. I'm talking the carbon concentration. Basically, they tend to mix up to form an intermediate phase which has a carbon concentration between that of the martensite and ferrite. Because the severe deformation effectively alloys the martensite and the ferrite, makes them mix together and form one single solid solution. And that also contributes to strength. Smaller contribution than the grain size contribution, but nevertheless, it's an important addition to the strength. Now, of course, in Taiwan, work like this is also being done at the National Taiwan University. This is Professor Yang, and I believe Hansen is somewhere in this audience. Yeah, okay. So what they have done is they've taken stainless steel wire with a starting microstructure which looks like this. So we have equiax grains of austenite, these are annealing pins. Okay? And then you severely deform the wire by drawing, produce extremely fine fibers. And the deformation results in these very elongated grains. Look at the scale here. This is 300 nanometers here. And these are the widths of the grain after the growing operation. So you introduce a huge amount of deformation. And Hansen managed to do transmission electron microscopy on the individual thread of this material. So imagine how difficult this is. Okay? To make a TEM specimen out of something which is finer than a hair. And of course the important thing is that we have produced fine grains, and the grains, adjacent grains, have a significant difference in orientation because the strength of a boundary also depends on the relative orientation of the adjacent grains. And this is a high resolution image. You can see lattice fringes. Lattice fringes are effectively planes of atoms. Okay, and this is a boundary between two of those adjacent grains. And you can see that the planes are misoriented as they cross the boundary. And the misorientation here is quite large. You will see in my last lecture that a 20 degree misorientation is a large misorientation. And contributes to strength. If this was only a very small misorientation, for example, the cells that you get when you deform aluminium, that wouldn't contribute very much to the strength. So, in the first part of this lecture, I've demonstrated to you that it's possible to get very, very high strength by actually introducing defects into the material. But there are also very big disadvantages with this method of introducing strength. Because you have to deform the material, and you have to put so much strain that you're limited in the size of the material you can produce. Okay? If I go back one slide, you know, we are talking about wires which are very fine. If I wanted to make a bridge out of this, it would be incredibly expensive. Yeah. Let me just show you what the scale of this is in terms of the sort of things that we use in everyday life. You know, just like I explained to you the physical meaning of strength in using an apple, I want to show you what the size of wires like Cypher and this wire is. So when you buy clothes, okay, like this, or stockings, the thread is measured in units called deniers, D-E-N-I-E-R-S, deniers. Okay. And it's a very, very strange unit of measurement. Okay. So one denier is the weight in grams of 9 kilometers of fiber. Now don't ask me how somebody decided to define a denier in this way. Okay? But one denier is the weight in grams of 9 kilometers of fiber. And women's stockings are about 10 deniers. The size of the thread is about 10 deniers. And men's socks are about 50 deniers in diameter. Now, cipher, the 5.5 gigapascal wire, is 9 deniers in size. So it's incredibly fine. So whenever you produce a material which is strong by using severe deformation, the form, the shape of the product will always be limited by the deformation process. So you will either produce very thin sheets or very fine wire, but not a very large piece of material. So this is one method of producing nanocrystalline metal, but it is limited because we can only produce certain shapes of material. Now one advantage of this method is that if I look at the strength over here, I want you to focus on this. Against the size of the wire, the diameter of the wire, is relatively insensitive to size. That is a good property to have. You don't want the strength to vary a great deal with the size, because in any engineering application you are going to have tolerances. You might get one wire which is wider than another wire, and then you will if you have large variations in strength, that's not a good thing. When you produce high strength by deformation, the strength is insensitive to the size of the material as long as the amount of strain is the same. So this is a good thing, that we do not want material which is very sensitive to the size. I'll talk about this part of the curve later. But another method of producing very high strength is actually to remove all the defects, to get perfect crystals. Because you can think about defects as reducing the strength of a perfect crystal. You know, the classical theory, if you go back something like 70 years, the classical theory of strength was that you pull the atoms apart. And the strength required to do that in iron is of the order of 14 gigapascals. Very, very high strength. But when we do an experiment, we never get 14 gigapascals. That's because we have dislocation. Dislocation can move much more easily than pulling atoms apart. However, if we can remove dislocation, then we can get very high strength. Now, how can we remove dislocation? Well, if we make our material smaller and smaller, then the chance of finding a defect also becomes smaller. If I have a large volume, then the probability of finding a defect is also large. This is the reason why when you take a glass fiber, you can bend it like this. But if you take a glass rod and you try to bend it, it will shatter into many pieces. Because the glass rod is larger in diameter, and therefore the chance of finding a defect is also larger. So the reason why glass fiber you can bend is that the chances of finding a defect are smaller, because the fiber has a smaller diameter. This is the classic Griffith experiment. Now similarly, with iron, if I can make single crystals which are very small, then I can get almost the theoretical strength of iron, 10 gigapascals, 10 billion apples on 1 square meter. Okay. Look at the size over here, this is in micrometers. If I can make perfect crystals of iron, this is an experimental curve, then I can get a very high strength. The problem, of course, is that the strength is very sensitive to size. See how it collapses as my crystal becomes larger. Because you can't avoid defects. Now let me qualify that statement, that you can't avoid defects. I will demonstrate to you that there is an equilibrium concentration of defects. That means it doesn't matter how long I anneal the material. If I anneal it for 20 years, you will still have a certain equilibrium concentration of defects. So any method in which you produce strength by eliminating defects, you will have a big problem, that the strength is very sensitive to size. Extremely sensitive to size. Now, in the literature, the modern literature, there is a lot being discussed about carbon nanotubes. And a carbon nanotube basically looks like this. It's a tube of carbon atoms. Yeah? Everybody familiar with carbon nanotubes? And you can make that by burning carbon appropriately, and you will produce carbon nanotubes. It's not difficult to produce that. And you can find papers which claim that the strength of a carbon nanotube is 130 gigapascals. Amazing strength. And this has led people to think about what you can do with something that is 130 gigapascals strong. Of course, at the same time, it's very light. Now, the way you calculate the strength of this is also a bit odd. That, of course, how do you define the cross-sectional area of a carbon nanotube? Yeah? So you have to think carefully about what this number means. But you can find modern papers which propose to use 130 gigapascal strength to construct an elevator to go into space. So instead of going into space by a rocket, you build a lift to go into space. So let me explain that a bit further. Arthur C. Clarke, the science fiction writer, predicted a long time ago that if you go to a height of about 30,000 kilometers, then and fall or to go that way. This part of the cable is there to hold the cable up, because you need a force to hold the cable. Yes? If I only went to this point, it would then fall back to Earth because of the weight of the cable here. So I need all this cable as a counterweight. Yes, so that it's pulling the cable and maintaining it straight. And then I can climb up the rope. Yes? So this is the basic idea of an elevator which goes into space. And the way it would work is like this. This is a spaceship which goes into geostationary orbit and drops the cable this way and allows the other end of the cable to float out to 120,000 kilometers. Then, once the cable is out, you fire another spaceship which goes and puts a weight at the end of the cable, okay? And then you can have a lift which goes out to space. Presumably, you save a lot of money by not firing rockets all the time. Okay? So the idea is to make an elevator which goes up and down this cable. So let's not worry about, you know, what happens if the carbon oxidizes in oxygen and so forth and so on. Let me show you why this concept is fundamentally incorrect. And it's impossible to do this, even in principle. Okay? Why it is impossible, even in principle, to consider such a concept. Even though millions and millions of dollars are being spent on this research. Okay? So NASA itself, you know, I believe, has a budget of $17 million for this concept. So I want to show you simple elementary theory which we teach to undergraduates, okay, which shows that this is fundamentally impossible concept. So even if you could make a cable which is 120,000 kilometers long, it would be useless. Okay? So let me show you how we do that. It goes back to my original point that in order to get strength from something that is perfect, you mustn't have defects. Yeah? Right, so let's consider thermodynamics. Right. Now, this is the Gibbs free energy. This is the enthalpy. This is the entropy, and this is temperature. Now, let's say that the energy, the energy to make the defect is delta H. Yeah. Just like a dislocation has an energy per unit length. Let's say that there is a carbon atom missing inside the nanotube, and the enthalpy change required to remove that carbon atom is delta H. It doesn't matter what it is, it can be very large. Yeah. Now, of course, when I remove one carbon atom, it becomes possible to arrange the other carbon atoms in many, many different ways. Yeah, because I now have a vacant site, and I can put that vacant site on many other locations. And that effectively means that I've increased the configurational entropy. So this is the delta H term, the delta S term. And this is the expansion of the delta S term. Now I'm going to set the free energy change to zero because we are working at equilibrium. The enthalpy change opposes the formation of the defect. The entropy change favors the formation of the defect because nature likes to increase entropy. And you can increase entropy by introducing a defect. Now, here we have the number of atoms involved. So if I'm talking about a carbon nanotube, it's a small number of atoms. If I'm talking about a rope which is 120,000 kilometers long, then it is a huge number of atoms. Huge number of atoms. So this part scales with the number of atoms we have in our unit that we are measuring the strength of. Now notice that at any temperature, I have always got some defect. Yeah? If I look at this equation, x has a finite value. Yeah? And the value of x, which is the concentration of defect, will increase as the number of units in my material changes. Okay? When I make a rope which is 120,000 kilometers, it will contain an equilibrium number of defects, and the strength will collapse. So if you make a rope, even 1 centimeter long, okay, the strength collapses to 1 gigapascal. Yeah? So this concept of making and elevating